So welcome once again to Luke, Ironside, who is a student and researcher of philosophy and religion and the esoteric. He's currently doing a distant learning study with the University of Oxford on Hindu philosophy.
Religious
studies. And today he's going to, he is also a theosophist, it's Worthing Lodge. So he's well versed in all things esoteric and theosophical. And we welcome him today to discuss the Bhagavad Gita, Karma Yoga and the Ageless Wisdom.
Thank you very much. For... First of all, it is a great honour for me to attend the Leeds Lodge today, and I would like to thank Tim for the invitation. I'm very inspired by the Lodge's founder, Alfred Richard Orridge, and his writings on theosophy and philosophy. Today I will be speaking on the subject of the Bhagavad Gita, particularly in its relation and its continuing relevance to the theosophical tradition. The Gita emerges time and time again in theosophical literature, and its influence is such that H.P. Blavatsky requested that excerpts of the poetic translation by Sir Edwin Arnold be read each year on the anniversary of her death, commonly known as White Lotus Day. Various translations of the Gita have emerged in theosophical literature, most notably the edition prepared by the co-founder of the Theosophical Society, William Q. Judge, under the title of the Bhagavad Gita, the Book of Devotion. This edition remains the most commonly published and read version in theosophical circles today. Bhagavad Gita translates literally to Song of God, or the Lord's Song, and it forms one small part of the Mahabharata, the great epic of India, and the longest poem ever written in the history of literature, which is sometimes compared to the Iliad for its vast popularity and influence. It is said to have been written by the sage Vyasa, and is traditionally dated to approximately 3000 BCE, a date which is challenged by contemporary scholars, who more accurately date its composition to between the 5th and 2nd centuries BCE. Whilst the Gita has had a long and crucial impact on Indian spiritual and religious philosophy over the past two millennia, and remains to this day a central guide to ethical living in the Hindu tradition, it is in many ways also a universal epic, dealing with and exploring the fundamentals of the human condition, namely, as pertains to questions of ethical conduct, unresolved frustrations and inner conflict, the dilemmas of dutiful action, and the meaning of one's earthly existence in the light of spiritual truths. It was the influence of the Theosophical Society which largely served to introduce the Gita to the West. It is interesting to note that Mahatma Gandhi, who found in the Gita a prime source of inspiration for its emphasis on selfless service by the means of Karma Yoga, was first introduced to the text as a young man by theosophists in England where he was studying law. Previously possessing little interest in religious thought, the Gita served as an introduction to what would be a central influence on Gandhi's social philosophy in the years to follow. The Gita is set against the backdrop of a dynastic struggle upon the plains of Kurukshetra, where two factions of one large family, the Pandavas and the Kauravas, are engaged in a civil war for the throne of Hastinapura, commonly supposed to be the same location as modern Delhi. At the time of the Kurukshetra War, a blind king rules over Hastinapura, thus incapacitated by his blindness and unable to govern. His eldest son, Duryodhana, takes on the responsibilities of the state. It is Duryodhana who urges his father to banish his cousins, the Pandava princes, from the land. They are exiled for a 13-year period, during which time they establish allegiances with the neighbouring kingdoms, thus forming a vast army. This Pandava army is led by the warrior prince, Arjun, who, along with his charioteer, the avatar Krishna, rides out to the middle of the battlefield to survey the opposing hosts. It is here, amid the sands of Kurukshetra, that Arjun faces a moral dilemma stemming from his reluctance to fight, and in so doing, caused the death of his kinsman in the Kaurava faction. In his despondency, Arjun beseeches Krishna to relieve him of his duty, leading him to declare in the second chapter that, "I will not fight." In his reluctance, it is his reluctance to fight which sets the theme for the philosophical and metaphysical discourse between Krishna and Arjun in the main body of the text, in which Krishna urges Arjun to the fulfillment of his duty, explaining that it is both his karma and his dharma which have led him to this pivotal point, emphasizing that the duty of a soldier is to fight, and to fight well. The Bhagavad Gita, much like the Christian Bible and the Muslim Quran, is a text which can be, and often is, interpreted in myriad ways. Within its pages can be found such striking imagery and profound vistas of thought as to enrapture the heart of the poet. Yet, to the scholar of history, its value may be that of a floodlight upon the key philosophical questions of the age, which, in its role as an ethical treatise, has modified and coloured the thoughts and ideas of subsequent stages of history right up to the present day. The metaphysician may find within its pages the pinnacle of philosophical aspiration to unravel the mysteries of being, and the complexity of theological inquiry into the nature of the absolute.
Why was he so against fighting?
I'll get to the that sets the stage for this whole epic. Arjun's dilemma. He's on the one hand, it's his duty to fight as a warrior. He is born into the warrior caste. It's his duty to fight to defend his people and to reclaim his land. On the other side, he doesn't want to fight because to fight means causing violence against his cousins in the other, on the opposite side of the battlefield. So this causes this ethical dilemma. Should he fight and fulfill his duty, or should he not fight and then thus doing prevents the bloodshed that would occur? So that sets this the backdrop for this ethical and metaphysical discourse. For the individual also, the Gita offers principles of right conduct and words of wisdom, guidance, and consolation universal to the condition of man. It is a truly universal epic, and as such, need not disturb anyone in his own ideals. For the paths revealed in the Gita are as manifold as the devotees themselves. The path best suited to us being set forth by our karma and dharma and by the essence of our very nature. Along our chosen path, we may pick up snippets of wisdom, which we then add to our storehouse of spiritual knowledge. And yet our storehouse is seemingly unable to be filled, like a void, and we are never satisfied. We are endlessly thirsty for the nectar of Theosophia, the wisdom of the divine. And in the Gita one may find the sustenance to so quench such constant craving. And yet, the totality of the Lord's song is heard only at the final struggle, when the disciple seeks the warrior within. This is the great battle, where the individual soul must conquer the human aspect of its being and cross the threshold of immortality. Here the human is sacrificed upon the altar of the Superman. In the beginning sections of the Gita, Arjuna is led astray by his lower nature. It is his material perspective which regards non-action as the righteous path and induces his reluctance to fight. He provides excuse after excuse for as justification for his despondency, yet he is thinking on a merely material level and not in terms of the higher cosmic plan or his place within it. From the material standpoint, his perspective is laudable, and Krishna observes in his response that although the prince's words are foolish, they bear within them the seeds of wisdom. They are true, and yet not wholly true, a half-truth only, failing to show the flower of the inner doctrine of the wise. The subsequent 16 chapters of the Gita represent the inner transformation of the lower self into the real self, whereby Arjun, under the guidance and instruction of the avatar Krishna, comes the Superman. Glimpses of the supreme harmony attained in the moment of the final struggle may come to the disciple while toiling yet upon the lower planes of being. He may catch, here and there, a scattered note of truth, a pearl of wisdom amid the mire. Yet this occurs only when there is a disharmony in his nature, when a critical state of consciousness is to be surmounted. And when once the song is heard, even in part, the soul can never forget it, though darkness may temporarily enshroud the light on the path. From the theosophical perspective, the Bhagavad Gita, and indeed the Mahabharata as a whole, may be considered as being rooted in an evolutionary framework. By this interpretation, the Gita can be understood as an allegorical account of the evolutionary development of humanity. In order to discover the inner message, it is necessary to move beyond the merely historical and mythopoetic aspects of the text, and instead to read between the lines for the psychological and evolutionary meaning underlying the Gita's central message. Such a reading between the lines leads to some intriguing interpretations of characters and events. The blind king, Dhritarashtra, can thus be understood as representing the material aspect of existence. The human body, or mortal envelope, acquired by the eternal monad for the purpose of going through its evolutionary journey, and which comes into being by the force of tanha, the craving or thirst for life, which draws one back into physical rebirth. His blindness is representative of the fact that the material body possesses no inherent power of sight or feeling, and is thus merely senseless matter. It is only the self within which is the substratum of the phases of consciousness and form. Dhritarashtra is therefore incapacitated for governing, the responsibilities of the state falling instead to his eldest son, Duryodhana. Theosophy conceives of two lines in the evolution of man, that of spirit and that of matter. It is by the coalescence of spirit and matter that the entire manifested universe is brought into being. In the Gita, the Kaurava faction can be seen as representing the material side of this double line, with the Pandava princes standing for the spiritual side. Arjuna, as one of the Pandava princes and the protagonist of the story, represents the immortal spark. The Mahabharata identifies Arjuna with Nara, the primeval man or eternal spirit pervading the universe, and Krishna with the divine Narayana, together forming a deity pair called Nara-Narayana. The Brahmin and theosophist Subhara, in his notes on the Bhagavad Gita, similarly conceives of Arjuna or Nara as representing the human monad, with Krishna or Narayana as representing the higher self, or the universal logos. Krishna is thus the pure eternal spirit, or the one universal self of all, referred to in Sanskrit as Atman. As such, he is the innermost essence of each and every human being, a fact revealed by Krishna in the 7th chapter. Arjuna, as the representative of man, stands at the threshold of the unfoldment of higher powers. In this regard, Arjuna represents not only man as a race, but every individual who seeks to develop their higher nature. And yet this unfoldment comes at a cost, as our lower nature must be left behind in the quest for the development of our higher faculties. Like Arjuna, we each must engage in a battle, yet the battle we fight is a battle with ourselves. It is a war waged with the objective of conquering our lower nature, in which the selfish tendencies of our lower faculties give way to the ultimate realization of absolute unity. In this interpretation, Kurukshetra is not merely a location in India, but rather the sacred plane of self-transformation upon which the base is transmuted into the sublime. It is the battlefield of spiritual evolution. In the allegorical interpretation, the battlefield of Kurukshetra becomes a further metaphor for the eternal now, the present moment of existence, suspended between the extremes of two seemingly irreconcilable choices, that of Arjuna's fulfillment of his duty as a warrior, and that of the avoidance of inevitable fratricide in the act of war against his kinsmen. The two choices are represented in the Gita by the opposing hosts on either side, as they await the battle start. And so the war is both external and internal, and a bridge is formed between the outer and the inner worlds. Here is also symbolized the field of Dharma, a word which has no clear equivalent in the English language, but which has been variously translated by such terms as duty, law, virtue, order. These terms, each touching upon key aspects of what is meant by the concept, while yet remaining incomplete in their definitions. Dharma is perhaps best understood as referring to right action, or the path of righteousness, and it is with such an understanding that I will discuss the term as a fundamental concept in the deontological system advocated by the Bhagavad Gita. Dharma is essentially the voice of intuition which entreats us to fulfill our natural duty, and which is itself dependent upon the variables of occupation, heredity, educational background, family responsibilities, and past accumulated karma. It is Dharma which provides a sense of meaning and integrity in the seeming turmoil of one's existence. It is that which nourishes the tendencies of our very nature and character, and the fulfillment of our intended duties. It is the fundamental significance of the concept to the Hindu tradition and the day-to-day lives of ordinary individuals in the substantial world, which places it at the core of the Gita's teachings, and it is for such a reason that it appears as the very first word of the text. The theosophist and occult author William Walker Atkinson, writing under the pseudonym of Yogi Ramacharaka, titles the first discourse of his edition of the Gita, The Gloom of Arjuna. And indeed, it may be seen from the outset that the Gita is essentially a tale of gloom, conflict, and despair. This arises from the seemingly contradictory obligations Arjuna is compelled to fulfill in accordance with his caste, or status as a warrior prince of the Pandava clan. Broadly interpreted, Dharma could be considered to include all the societal, familial, and traditional laws of the social structure which one inhabits, whilst likewise including one's responsibility to oneself as an individual. Here then, conflict is an inevitability. Life is not a straight line, a linear progression from one experience to the next, but rather a succession of crossroads which constantly challenge and conflict our preconceived notions of what is moral or right. The path of righteousness is thus a crooked path, not a simple set of thou shalt and thou shalt nots. In the chapter titled Dharma of his work, An Advanced Course in Yogi Philosophy and Oriental Occultism, William Walker Atkinson succinctly expresses this idea in his statement that the advanced student sees the absurdity of the old divisions of right and wrong, and knows that many things which have been condemned as wrong are wrong only because certain men arbitrarily have called them so, and that many things that have been called right are right only for the same reason. He looks around him and sees that right and wrong seem to differ with latitude and longitude, and that the conceptions of right and wrong vary with the ages and constantly are changing, being modified, improved upon, or rejected. From this perspective, then, Dharma is relative to the different contexts of the individual. What is right action for the warrior would be wrong action for the priest. And neither Dharma is better nor worse in the absolute sense, but is merely one's duty as ordained by Rita or cosmic law. Codes of ethics often become a puzzling dilemma for the advanced student, who in the rejection of the absolutes of right and wrong, finds himself perplexed regarding such a standard of ethics. Having lost, in his quest for the answer to the question of what is right, his old landmarks and codes, which previously proved satisfactory in a less developed state of consciousness. At the beginning of the second chapter of the Gita, we find Arjuna in a state of compunction and gloom, his eyes overflowing with tears. Krishna urges the prince to yield not thyself to this unmanly weakness, chiding him for acting disgracefully and contrary to his duty as a warrior. Arjuna's response reveals the reason for his reluctance to fight, namely, the act of waging war against the worthy and honourable men in the opposing faction. He goes on to state that, my compassion weighs down my heart even unto faintness, and my mind reels confusedly before the problem presented to it. What is right action for me? What is my duty? O most blessed Krishna, my Lord, decide these weighty questions for me. Tell me what is right. Here then, the dilemma faced by Arjuna is a sentimental one. His despondency and emotional despair have clouded his understanding, obscuring his sense of Dharma. He finds himself urged to inaction, contrary to his duty as a warrior. In the above passage, Arjuna is questioning Krishna as to the rightness or wrongness of an action. How can he know what is right action in accordance with his duty? This is a central question which the Bhagavad Gita attempts to address. It is only natural, when embarking on a course of action, to regard that as the right course. It is the propensity of man to consider his actions as right, and those others who are in opposition to his course of action as wrong. We are therefore faced with a contradiction. Who is truly right, then, if one man's right stands in conflict to another man's right? The Bhagavad Gita responds to this dilemma by stating that the rightness or wrongness of an action does not depend on the pleasure or pain of the individual. It is only natural to regard that which brings us pleasure or happiness as right, and that which brings us sorrow or pain as wrong. The Gita warns against such a sensory or hedonistic interpretation to the question of right or wrong, as expressed by Krishna in his response to Arjuna's despondency. The senses, through their appropriate faculties of the mind, give thee reports of cold and heat, pleasure and pain. But these changes come and go. They are shifting, transient, and inconstant. Bear them with equanimity, bravely and patiently, O Prince. For verily I say unto you, that the man whom these things have seized to further torment, he who stands steadfast, undisturbed by pleasure and pain, he to whom all things seem alike, such an one, I say, have acquired the road to immortality. And so our pleasure or pain, joy or sorrow, cannot be held as a standard of reference for the rectitude of our actions, as these are merely transitory and fleeting. There is no absolutism to be found in the feelings of pleasure or pain. Krishna's solution to the dilemma faced by Arjuna is threefold. Firstly, he emphasizes that in all our actions, we should be motivated by action for duty's sake, not by the feelings of pleasure or pain. This opens the way for Krishna's discussion on karma yoga, the path of selfless action, by which one may act free from the repercussions of karma. Secondly, if we are to act by the motive of action for duty's sake, with an attitude of devotion and an awareness of the divine plan ordering the affairs of the world, then our actions will be in accordance with right action. The devoted confidence in the midst of life's confusion is the way of bhakti yoga, the path of union through love for love's sake, and complete surrender to the divine. Thirdly, Krishna addresses the question of how to decide between the conflicting choices faced by Arjuna in his moral dilemma. The prince asks of Krishna, what is right action for me? Here Krishna responds that in order to learn the answer to this question, We must first discover the true nature of the self. We must realize our selfish desires, our feelings of pleasure and pain, and our confusions, fears, and uncertainties are not the self, but that we are, in fact, ourselves Krishna in our truest essence, as our higher self. The path to the realization of such is that of Jnani Yoga, the yoga of wisdom. In the third chapter, Krishna raises the topic of karma during his discussion of the nature of right action. After emphasizing that right action, important as it may be, must yield precedence to right thinking, and that one must strive towards the attainment of a state of consciousness which is able to rise above good and evil results, Krishna moves on to the topic of karma, or action. He states that those who have so far attained that they mentally relinquish the possible fruit of right action are on the road to the mastery of karma. Their chains which bind them to the round of involuntary rebirth become loosened, and in the end drop from their limbs and leave them free. Eternal bliss is in sight for these. Karma is a Sanskrit term for the spiritual cause, or the spiritual law of cause and effect. It relates to the intricate affinities that have been acquired by individual souls for many lifetimes. It manifests as characteristics in the psychological makeup of the individual. Under the operation of the law of karma, every man is a master of his own destiny, likewise his own judge and executioner. Karma binds us to the world of impermanence and prevents us from escaping the cycle of rebirth with its resultant sorrows of birth and death. It is only by detachment from the fruit of our actions that we may loosen the chains of karma and thus free ourselves from the bonds of samsara, the wheel of life, and attain nirvana or peace. Karma being action, the path of karma yoga advocated by Krishna in the Gita is that of the mastery of action. The Gita teaches that although there is but one goal to be sought by the seeker after wisdom, still there are many different paths whereby one may reach that same goal, each path being suited to the particular temperament of the individual. Such temperament is in no way the result of accident or chance, but is in fact the result of Dharma issuing forth from the particular development of the soul in its stage of evolution. Many of us in the West live in a world where a life of action is a necessity. This too is our Dharma. For many inhabitants of the Western world who take an interest in the subject of yoga, there is an objection that the philosophies and practices of the East are not adapted to the needs and requirements of the West. They consider the Eastern teachings concerning yoga to be fit only for those who dedicate themselves to a life of renunciation, in dreaming, meditating, and secluding oneself from the bustle and activity of the mundane world. This, however, is a great misconception. Although it is certainly true that some Eastern disciples follow this path of renunciation and obtain great benefits therefrom, no true teacher of the Eastern wisdom will advocate the secluded path as the only one applicable to all students. On the contrary, the master recognizes that what applies to the West also applies to the East, namely, that a life of activity is proper and right for those who, in accordance with their Dharma, find themselves thrust into the midst of such, and that to shirk or neglect the duties arising from this would be in direct violation of the great law of Dharma. This being the case, the path of renunciation is rendered practically impossible for many earnest disciples of the West, whose lives of intense activity and constant flux require them to follow the path dictated by their karma. The path of karma yoga is recommended as a solution by Krishna to the dilemma faced by Arjuna regarding right action. It is a method whereby Arjuna may live a worldly life as a warrior prince and yet never abandon his duty to uphold Dharma. By this path, one may perform their obligatory duties without suffering the consequences of the karmic backlash of their actions. This point is emphasized by Krishna in the fourth chapter of the Gita, where he speaks to Arjuna in the following words. But even the wise, at times, have been confused as to what was action and what inaction. Therefore, I will inform thee regarding this. I shall tell thee of what action consists of, knowing which thou shalt be relieved from evil and set free. He who would learn the truth concerning action must grasp these three things: action, inaction, and wrong action. Difficult to clearly discern is the path of action. He who has so far attained that he is able to see action and inaction, and inaction and action, is among the wise of his race, and to him cometh harmony and peace, even while he performeth actions. His works are free from the bonds of desire, and his activities are purged of their dross by the flame of wisdom. Having freed himself from attachment to the fruits of his actions, and not being dependent thereon, he is enjoying inaction even while in the very exercise of action. Freed from all and dependent upon naught, his mind and senses under control, he goeth through the motion of action, and seemeth even to perform it in the most approved and successful manner. But full well he knoweth that his real self is not entangled in the action, and is far above reward or punishment, for victory or defeat. He is released from the consequences of action, which are the bonds and chains holding down those who know not the truth. The Bhagavad Gita, then, does not preach renunciation of action, but rather renunciation of the attachment to the fruits of actions, and the dependence which arises from such. If one is to perform actions with the desire and attachment to results, then one must assume the karmic responsibility and face the consequences which result from such. He must taste the fruits from the tree of his planting, whether bitter or sweet, accepting either the sorrows or pleasures which emanate from his actions. In either case, such a one has no true freedom from the laws of mortal life. He is subjugated by the world and confined to its illusion. The path of karma yoga is not that of the escaping of action, for indeed it is impossible to remain inactive or to escape action altogether. We are driven to action by the conditions of our very nature and dharma, and thus freedom from action cannot be achieved by the mere renunciation of action. Even Krishna, in the Bhagavad Gita, engages in action and performs his duties as the cosmic preserver and arbitrator of Dharma. It is only by the performance of such action that he may ensure that fate runs its proper course, and that he may restore harmony to the world. The true student of Karma Yoga must follow Krishna's example in the performance of his actions. He must perform his natural duty without attachment to the fruits of such, even-minded in both success and failure, and free from the constraints of sorrow and happiness. This is the basic advice given by Krishna to Arjuna in a state of despondency, where Krishna enjoins him to put aside all thoughts of death or victory, stating that, if thou chance to be slain in the battle, the warrior's heaven wilt be thy reward. If victorious thou emergest from the fray, the joys of earth await thee. Therefore, O Prince of Pandu, arise and fight, being willing to take whatever betide of thee, be it pain or pleasure, loss or gain, victory or defeat, thine only concern being whether thou hast done thy best, prepare thou for the fray. That is your plain duty. A synopsis of the Gita's teachings on Karma Yoga can be found in the Theosophical classic Light on the Path, written in 1885 by Mabel Collins, who, as it so happens, was born on the island of Guernsey, where I was myself born. Like the Gita, Light on the Path intimates occult truths in the form of paradox. revealing both sides of the coin. This is indeed the way of nature. All proclamations of truth are but half-truths. There are two good sides to every argument. Any full statement of truth must therefore be paradoxical in its essential nature. In accordance with this, the light on the path guides us to follow the following four instructions, which may be seen to mirror the teachings of the Gita. 1. Stand aside in the coming battle, and though thou fightest, be thou not the warrior. 2. Look for the warrior, and let him fight in thee. 3. Take his orders for battle, and obey them. 4. Obey him, not as though he were a general, but as though he were thyself, and his spoken words were the utterance of thy secret desires. For he is thyself, yet infinitely wiser and stronger than thyself. Look for him, else in the fever and hurry of the fight, thou mayest pass him, and he will not know. He will not know thee, unless thou knowest him. If thy cry reaches listening ear, then will he fight in thee, and will fill the dull void within. And if this is so, then canst thou go through the fight, cool and unwearied, standing aside and letting him battle for thee. Then it will be impossible for thee to strike one blow amiss. But if thou look not for him, if thou pass him by, then there is no safeguard for thee. Thy brain will reel, thy heart grow uncertain, and in the dust of the battlefield thy sight and senses will fail, and thou wilt not know thy friends from thy enemies. He is thyself, yet thou art but finite and liable to error. He is eternal and is sure. He is eternal truth. And once he has entered thee and become thy warrior, he will never utterly desert thee, and at the day of the great peace he will become one with thee. These four precepts are illustrations of the law of paradox. The key to their decipherment lies in the ability to distinguish between the relative and absolute points of view. The warrior here referred to is the real self, or Atman, which exists within the soul of every man, and which struggles constantly to cast from itself each encumbering sheaf of the lower self which so hinders it in its quest for total expression. When one has sufficiently freed oneself from the bonds of Maya or illusion, which constrain and restrict self, then will the spirit act through him and guide him in his actions. We are told firstly to stand aside in the coming battle, a statement which may bemuse and shock many of us, particularly in the light of the Gita's rejection of the renunciation of action. Yet on closer inspection, we may see that this precept does not command us to flee from the battle or to hide and seek seclusion, but on the contrary, it expressly assumes that we will fight. Standing aside refers to the surrendering of the lower self to the guidance of the real self. It is not a withdrawal from the world, but it is rather a standing aside by which one may see himself act. He is able to take his place in the great game of life, and though performing his appointed work and duty, he may feel certain that while in it, he is not of it. He is led by spirit through the struggle, unhindered in the performance of his duty. The second precept follows directly from the first. It tells us to look for the warrior and let him fight in thee. This warrior is our real self, represented in the Gita by the Lord Krishna. We must seek him out, believe in him, trust in him, and recognize him. We must let him take the reins of the chariot and fight the battle on our behalf. The third precept instructs us to take his orders for battle and obey them. There will be times in life when we are placed in certain exposed positions, where the enemy's fire is concentrated upon us, and from which place retreat seems an impossibility. Yet we must have absolute trust in the guidance of the self to lead us through the fray. For there is a plan behind the orders, and triumph is certain in the end. One may suffer, temporarily, the pains and sorrows of the battle, yet these are but fleeting and unreal. and must fade before the greater realization of the victory to come. The fourth precept tells us to obey him, not as though he were a general, but as though he were thyself, and his spoken words were the utterance of thy secret desires. For he is thyself, he is infinitely wiser and stronger than thyself. We are here warned against considering our real self as something separated and distinct, an outside entity or thing apart from ourself. We must come to recognize the self within, else we cannot expect the self to work through us and guide us in the battle. When we step aside from the fight, disheartened and discouraged as we are, and instead lets the real self battle for us, then we gain that feeling of calm content, knowing that the warrior is invincible, and that the battle must be ours in the end. Only then do we truly acquire that peace that passeth understanding. The karma yogi walks a middle path. He is unattached to the world of Maya whilst yet engaged in it, and thus a balance is struck between the extremes of renunciation and worldliness. The path of karma yoga is the ability to conscientiously evaluate one's actions and the motivation for such, and to act without attachment to the fruits of actions. The karma yogi steps aside in the fight, allowing the real self to take the reins of the chariot and to lead us successfully through the field of action to the inevitable victory that awaits us. Yet karma yoga is not the only path that one may take in the quest for inner realization. Okay. In the 7th to 12th chapters of the Gita, Krishna teaches the path of devotion, or bhakti yoga, whereby the disciple may grow into an understanding and union with the Absolute by the power of love. Bhakti yoga stems from the heart of the disciple rather than from the intellect. Of course, one may be both a karma yogi and at the same time be filled with this reverence and love of the Absolute, which is characteristic of bhakti yoga. There is no contradiction to be found there, and many a seeker walks a twofold path along the way of liberation. Bhakti yoga is often seen manifested in the religious instinct of man, tendency towards worship in one form or another. Even those who would self-identify as freethinkers, agnostics, or atheists recognize and feel this instinctive urge and manifest it in the love of nature, art, or music. This instinct is indeed the common heritage of mankind. In bhakti yoga, the emphasis is on love, not merely in its emotional aspect, but its dedication and surrender of the self to the ultimate reality. We see this devotional nature expressed clearly in Christianity, where the virtues of love, grace, and compassion are emphasized and extolled. It is a path which, for many seekers of a devotional nature, aids them in ascending the mountain peak of spiritual liberation, at the peak of which it is their joy to lose themselves in the adoration of the Absolute. In the final six chapters of the Gita, Krishna raises the topic of Jnani Yoga, the path of wisdom, and the final stage and the goal of the realization of the self. It is this path to which men and women of an intellectual or philosophical temperament are often attracted. Yet all of us are seeking wisdom, and the wisdom referred to in the path of Jnani is that which may be derived from direct acquaintance with the real self. It concerns itself with the questions of the why and wherefore of life, the riddle of the universe. In the 14th chapter of the text, Krishna explains to Arjuna that he will reveal the supreme wisdom, that wisdom of all wisdom the best, that wisdom by which the wise ones mounted unto the heights of supreme attainment and perfection. The purpose of Jnani Yoga is the achievement of liberation from the ignorance and limitations of phenomenal existence, and the realization of one's true identity as the Atman or Self. Krishna emphasizes that the path of Jnana consists at arriving at a proper understanding of the difference between the knower and the known, as expressed in his final statement of the 13th chapter of the Gita. And he, who by the power of spiritual wisdom, doth perceive this difference between the soul and the material or personal self, between the soul and nature and nature's principles, between the knower and the known, verily, he perceiveth the liberation of the soul from the illusion of matter and personality. And he passeth to the spiritual consciousness, in which all is seen as one reality, without illusion or error. And so this ultimate goal of Jnana Yoga is attained in the absolute liberation of the self from the bondage of Maya, which is achieved through the discrimination between untruth and truth, the unreal and the real. In this state, the disciple achieves knowledge of the impersonal and formless aspect of the Absolute, Brahman, which is seen to transcend the dualities and differentiations of existence, being neti-neti, neither this nor that. This is moksha, the mystical experience of self-realization, in which the student arrives at an understanding of the absolute identity between the individual self, or Atman, and the Absolute, or Brahman. In the Hindu tradition, this realization of the identity between the self and the Absolute is expressed in the phrase Tat Vam Asi, which translates to That Thou Art. It is a statement of the individual's relationship with Brahman, or the Absolute, through the indwelling spirit. In reading the Gita, the observant student will notice that at certain points in the text, Krishna is speaking not only as the higher self, or Atman, and at other times as the universal Logos, but that he on occasion even speaks as the Absolute, Brahman, or Parabrahma. In the 7th chapter of the Gita, Krishna speaks to Arjuna on the topic of spiritual discernment, and the nature of the relationship between the world and Krishna as the Absolute. He states, "For I am the creator of the universe. Likewise, I am the dissolution of the universe. Higher than I, there is naught. All the objects of the universe depend upon me and are sustained by me, even as precious gems depend upon the thread which passes through them, holding all together and sustaining them. In this world, we see that there is an order which prevents the onset of chaos. The world moves forward in accordance with designated laws, and yet we cannot perceive the principle of existence which directly sustains that order. Similarly, a necklace of jewels is held in place by the invisible thread that is its sustaining principle. The thread is broken, the cosmos will collapse in a ravaging tempest of chaos. Here Krishna, as the Absolute, proclaims himself to be the invisible thread that so sustains the order of the universe. Krishna, therefore, although invisible to the seeking of the finite mind, is present within the emanations, within its emanations in the world of forms. Without his presence, the world could not continue to exist. However, though the Absolute may be present, in a manner of speaking, in the world of forms, it is not dependent upon the existence of the world in any sense. The world, contrarily, is entirely dependent upon the Absolute. Thus there is an identity between the universe and the Absolute, but it is not a symmetrical identity. The world is nothing but a manifestation or emanation of the Absolute, which is itself beyond the world of forms. Krishna further refers to himself as the eternal seed of all nature, the wisdom of the wise, the glory of the glorious, and the strength of the strong. The three natures of harmony, activity, and inactivity exist in him, and yet Krishna is not in them. He stands above them, untouched and unchanged, even amid the countless changes and happenings of the world. Krishna states that there are four classes of devotees who come to him. Those are the distressed, the seekers after knowledge, seekers after worldly success, and the wise ones. Of these four, he regards the wise as the best. It is they who come directly to Krishna in his truest form, and in their absolute devotion achieve union with him. He informs Arjuna that, after many lives, and with the accumulated wisdom, the wise ones come to me, knowing me to be all. Such are called Mahatmas, and are rare and difficult to find by lesser men. And the others, who are drawn away through lack of understanding, to this deity, or that one, with varying rites and ceremonies, find other gods, they find that which they seek, according to their natures. Here we can see the essential importance of the doctrine of reincarnation to the teachings of the Bhagavad Gita. The topic of reincarnation is first introduced by Gita in the second chapter of the text in response to Arjuna's reluctance to fight, and in so doing caused the death of his kinsman. Krishna emphasizes the fact that the truly wise grieve neither for the dead nor the living. Understanding that the body at death is but a worn-out garment, which may be discarded by the dweller within. To the wise, life and death are but words, these being but the surface aspects of the spirit of man. In the theosophical cosmology, man is evolving both on a physical and a spiritual level. Spiritual evolution takes place over a succession of individual lifetimes, through the process of reincarnation and a series of esoteric initiations. In the process of his evolution, man comes to see higher attributes and qualities in his conception of deity, and he transfers his former, less developed idea for that of the higher idea of his present state. And so, in the infancy of man's evolution, he lacks any conception of a single god, instead conceiving of many gods, each expressing and exhibiting some particular aspect of the one, some phase of life or form of human feeling, passion or thought. This is polytheism, with its myriad gods of war, of death, of love, of fertility, of healing, wisdom, justice, and so on. This is the primal urge of man for a touch of the divine, the religious instinct that will in time lead man to a worship of the One. These gods are clothed with human attributes, those of love and hate, happiness and despair, jealousy, revenge, and retribution. In time, man emerges to a monotheistic conception of God. He conceives of a God who plays favorites with his creation, rewarding his worshippers and inflicting ills upon his enemies. This God is a friend to his chosen people, and yet an enemy to all others. As such, he delights in their annihilation and the shedding of pagan blood, even to the extent of the slaughter of women and their babes. Yet this God is, at the last, merely a symbol for the predominant values of the race to which he is attached. He acts as they would act, and thinks as they would think. He is like man, only a little in advance. Man's conceptions of God never remain the same for long. In fact, man is constantly improving God, casting down the God of his forefathers, and erecting in its place a refined conception. And so the God of the Old Testament differs significantly from the God of the New Testament, and the God of the Christian Church today is different from the God of 2 centuries ago. Krishna addresses this directly in multiple sections of the Bhagavad Gita. In the 4th chapter, he informs Arjuna that, no matter by what path men approach me, they are made welcome, for all paths, no matter how diverse, lead straight to me. All paths are mine, notwithstanding by what names they may be called. Even those who tread the path of the lower deities and imaginary gods, and who pray to them for success through action, even these, say I, meet with reward. For they reap the success that comes from earnest application and industrious action. Through the laws of mind and nature, do their gods, real or imagined, answer them. Returning to our previous verse, But Krishna states that in the course of many lifetimes, the wise ones come to him. We see a progression of this idea. Whilst all are welcomed by Krishna as they approach him, only those who are truly wise may come to understand him in his ultimate form as the All. These wise ones he calls the Mahatmas, a term familiar to theosophists and students of the Eastern traditions generally. The term is Sanskrit for great soul, and it is used to designate a revered person regarded by their followers with love and respect, such as a holy person or sage. It is similar in its denotation to the modern Christian term saint, although the theosophical conception transcends this definition to refer more specifically to a highly evolved person who is involved in overseeing the spiritual growth of mankind and the development of human civilizations. They are often also referred to by the terms of adepts or masters, and the American theosophist Dr. Alvin Boyd Kuhn offers the following statement regarding their identity in his 1930 work, The Mahatmas and Their Letters. The masters whom theosophy presents to us are simply high-ranking students of life's school of experience. They are members of our own evolutionary group, not visitants from the celestial spheres. They are supermen only in that they have attained knowledge of the laws of life and mastery over its forces, with which we are still struggling. A parallel can also be drawn between the Mahatmas and the Buddhist concept of the Bodhisattvas, the term used to denote an individual who has reached enlightenment and who has the option to pass beyond samsara, the wheel of rebirth, but elects instead to reincarnate for the sake of assisting mankind along the path to enlightenment. Krishna emphasizes that such are rare and hard to find by lesser men. Possessing such higher faculties and spiritual knowledge as not yet attained by ordinary humanity. These wise ones, appropriately referred to in some theosophical literature as the Lords of Compassion, have in their selflessness renounced the bliss of nirvana, in order that they may be the guiding lights to lead the strengthened souls safely home, and that they may assist in the realization of the oneness of all, which lies at the foundation of a true brotherhood of humanity. This notion of the oneness of all can be perceived as the central note in the resounding melody of the Gita's song. It is by the ignorance of this essential unity that we become ensnared in the illusion of Maya, blinded by the shadows of our own making. Like the prisoners in Plato's cave, we watch them dance and play upon the walls, content in the pleasures of our delusion. Though comforting as the shadows are, in the final analysis they are but shadows and must fade, as shadows do, before the splendour of the light. It can be sometimes easy to forget, when standing amidst the blackest shadows, that darkness surrounds the pavilion of God. When we cast the shadows away, confidently bearing the torch of truth, we find that only light remains, and yet this light is also darkness. For, as Blavatsky states in The Secret Doctrine, light and darkness are identical in themselves, being only divisible in the human mind. There is no true division or duality. All is one at the last. In this lecture, I have addressed and discussed some of the current central themes of the Bhagavad Gita, in particular the concepts of Dharma, Karma, Yoga, and Moksha, specifically as they relate to theosophical teachings and ideas. I have discussed the theosophical interpretation of the Gita as fitting into an evolutionary framework, of which careful reading between the lines can open up new and interesting layers of meaning within the text. Although an ancient scripture steeped in the traditions of Vedic India, the Bhagavad Gita remains a relevant and universal guide to spiritual and ethical living in the world today. It is for this reason that it has had such an impact on the philosophy of such diverse figures as Mahatma Gandhi and J. Robert Oppenheimer, and it continues to spread an influence and popularity in both the East and the West. Translations are many, and the interpretations greater still, yet underlying all may be found the essential message of unity, and the Gita's unique perspective into the true nature of ethics and right conduct. I will end with a final quote from Krishna to Arjuna on the topic of unity and the knowledge of the real self. He who hath found the peace within, and who hath been so ill-immuned that he findeth his joy and happiness within himself, and knoweth that within him is the kingdom of heaven, verily he gaineth the peace of the real self, because he hath blended himself with the real self. They, from whom the illusion of duality and separation have been removed, see all life as one, and emanating from one. The welfare of the all becomes the welfare of the one to them, and to such cometh the peace of the one. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Quite a lot there.
Yes, I've not read the Bhagavad Gita in its entirety, but I have read sections of it.
Sure.
Now, being a spiritualist by nature, I find I've got issue with one thing. You'll probably correct me on this, that the Bhagavad Gita advocates that at death, or transition.
Mm-hmm.
We hit the ground running, so to speak. We go straight into another body at death, at birth, which I would maintain that, being a spiritualist by origin, that we don't do that. We like to review our past life before we actually go into another body. Can you just enlighten me on that?
Sure. Well, I think it's important to remember the context of the Bhagavad Gita as rising out of the Hindu tradition. And so the Bhagavad Gita has within its message and meaning and within the epic of its story, it contains basic Hindu ideas regarding reincarnation. I think, As I stated in my talk, that the Bhagavad Gita can be, and very often is, interpreted in many ways. Krishna does touch upon reincarnation at multiple points throughout the text. I have found, though, that in different translations, and that this can be very differently interpreted. And I think very often that one's own religious or spiritual persuasions have a significant influence when translating a text. So Vedantic translations of the Gita will have a particular viewpoint or a particular will flavor it, if you like, in a particular way, and that scholarly interpretations will have a different kind of understanding. And so I would say that at the end of the day, it's most important to not take the Gita as some kind of infallible scripture, because it's not. It's rooted in the day and age of its composition. It's rooted in a particular religious tradition, and although many aspects of its teachings are universal, from my perspective, and which I've tried to explain in my talk here, I think that other aspects of it are clearly Vedic and Hindu in their interpretation and may not be applicable to those outside of the Hindu or Indian traditions. Yeah. That would be my answer to that.
Yeah.
We have the speaker coming on the 4th of December who's talking on regression.
Yes.
And that will include life between lives, as I understand it. But I would add, you know, I think what you're saying is you come straight, it's suggesting you come straight into another body without anything in between, but that's just our concept of time here, which doesn't apply elsewhere.
My belief is reversal to that. We review our past lives.
Oh, we might well do, you see.
We rest, we don't know, I don't know. But before we actually become back on Earth again in another body. Yeah. Well, that's what I've been.
Yes, I'm aware. I'm aware of that. Well, I just think we have our time in this existence, which may not apply. You know, a second. You know, just it's no meaning. I wouldn't compare second might be a million years might be a second.
Yeah.
You know, who knows?
Yeah.
Mary?
Well, maybe depending on your spiritual evolution to how long you will stay in the revealing state, spiritual state. Some, if they're really advanced, they may want to come back straight away. I don't know, to help out or for different reason. Some might want to spend hundreds of years on the astral or whatever. These,
again, I think there are many paths, one of which is to come back.
Whatever, so they might want to. I don't know who says you have to get back or whose law it is, but surely we'll come back when we're ready for this life to begin again. You know, when we're ready to sort of take it on. So depending on maybe how we're evolved here will be, depending how long we stay there or what takes place. And I've heard that if someone, they die suddenly, they can be thrown back into the world straight away. So that, I think there's any straight answer. What you were saying, something on those lines.
Well, in Hinduism, there's the idea of Rita, or a cosmic law, which everything fits into this cosmic law. And so that includes individual dharma, the evolutionary framework, which everything fits into. So what happens, according to the Hindu tradition, what happens after death would be very dependent upon where that individual fits into the cosmic plan.
Yeah.
So for some, so an immediate reincarnation would be.
Yeah.
Will be. And then the passion.
I don't know. None of us do. But I would have thought that it would depend upon where you are. Where you go after your bodily death. And what you've got to work off.
The karma.
Yes. And as you gradually work off, you'll move into to different sections and come across the one which ends with incarnation. But I would have thought that most people would welcome a rest.
Yeah. A long one.
Yeah, I know.
No rest for the wicked, Ruby.
Yeah, that's what I'd like to believe.
Natasha?
It seems to me, judging from your presentation, that Bhagavad Gita is a guidance on a particular course of action when a conflict of interest exists,
say, between
a hero and that other. But in other traditions, for example, Middle Asian traditions, sort of Uzbek and Tajik region, there are clearer guidances when the conflict of interest exists. And I will just elaborate on it, but before that, I would like to tell a fable, which will probably clarify my point of view. The two wise ones have been friends for a long time without ever having an argument. One day they decided to test each other and try to feel how do people argue. So they started arguing about a fial. One man took the fial to himself and said, "It's mine." The other one took the fial out of his hand and said, "No, it's mine." And his friend said, "Okay, if you need it, let it be yours." So the argument never actually materialized. And it seemed to me that that guidance on the behavior of people when the conflict of interest exists, that the wise ones, or in your words, the more enlightened or developed, simply allow things to be. They accept it as a given and do nothing. The middle course of action, which most people engage in, is to enter into a discourse and perhaps a negotiation. If it goes in a favorable way, perhaps they will resolve their conflict of interest. But if not, then perhaps an argument ensues. And that argument leads to a third course of action, which Bhagavad Gita probably will see as, I don't know, the least desirable course of action, the least enlightened, which means going to an open conflict or war. Does it mean that this this kind of guidance is clearer than what Bhagavad Gita right. offers?
I understand the point of the of your example there. The Bhagavad Gita has a basic assumption that conflict is an inevitability. It's not that one always seeks conflict. It's not that one who is wise should seek conflict. It's that whether one likes it or not, conflict happens, and that try as one might to avoid conflict, conflict will find you. The conflict will occur in life. There will be a moment in life where you are faced with a conflict and must choose how to act. So what's interesting is that Krishna's initial response to this conflict is, I don't want to fight. I want to step back and not engage myself in the violence or in the warfare. And Krishna's immediate response to that is, you must fight. It is your duty to fight. It's not about the pleasure or pain that may occur as a result of your actions. It's about the fact that your duty is to fight. It's what fits into the cosmic plan. And so Krishna talks about the dangers of inaction, of not acting. I think we are all faced with conflicts, very often on a daily basis, where if we didn't act, if we chose not to act, it could cause more harm in the big picture than responding to the conflict in one way or another. I think that's something that can be derived from the Gita as well, the idea that of right action, of dharma, duty, responding to action in the best possible way, because sometimes the lack of action or inaction causes more damage and more harm than engaging in the action. And yet Krishna emphasizes this path of karma yoga, action in inaction and inaction in action. Basically, we act. One may act, but without an attachment to the results of those actions. One acts because it's the right thing to do, not because they want to get a raise in their job or derive some pleasant benefit from that action. One acts simply because it is in accordance with what is right. And also, in Mabel Collins' Light on the Path, we have this idea of, though thou fightest, be thou not the warrior. So it's acting, but allowing the innate self to do to act on your behalf, instead of acting from the lower state of consciousness of the ego, of the lower self. And so in some cases, dharma being very relative to the context of the individual, in some cases, inaction would probably be the right path. There would be some cases where the avoidance of conflict altogether would be in accordance with that individual's dharma. But in other cases, refusing to engage in the conflict could cause more harm than...
I think there is a slight semantic ambiguity between okay. what is action and what is inaction. Clearly, action means entering into a conflict, and inaction means stepping back and perhaps acquiesce. But both of these are actions.
Yes.
A very positive action of giving in or accepting a situation is an action as well.
Yes, that's right. And I think that brings us back to this idea of the paradoxical nature of the teachings of the Bhagavad Gita. There is a paradox there in that inaction and action can be seen to be one and the same thing in the final analysis. Yes.
This is about the nature of action as well, isn't it?
Yes, it is. It is very much a text on the nature of action. That's right.
Yeah, thanks. You mentioned, is it Krishna was from a certain caste?
Oh, Arjun, the prince,
sorry,
yes.
Arjun, sorry, yeah.
Yes.
And you mentioned duty as well.
Sorry?
His duty?
His duty, yes, in accordance with his caste.
In accordance with his caste. Now,
yes.
That, in my opinion, that's been hijacked by Indian society. And he's created a caste system.
Yes.
How do you think to stop that conflict as well and not create a conflict? Again,
right.
That's kept people in certain castes as well.
That's right.
They believed some of these, but what you're talking about.
Yes.
So I'm not saying anything against it, I'm just saying, how would you enlighten people to say, look,
okay.
How do you think that's played with the caste system? How
yes.
do you think people who feel like they've been disadvantaged are advantaged?
So the caste system fits into a certain hierarchy in Indian culture, which has become less less dominant in the past 100 years by the efforts of such figures as Vivekananda and other such, and Gandhi and other people in the modern Hindu tradition who have attempted to bring down the caste system to some extent. But the Bhagavad Gita at the age of its composition was rooted in this understanding of the world as fitting into a caste structure. So once again, it's simply a construct of its age. And I think when you take the allegorical approach, the caste system doesn't need to be seen so much as a physical reality, so it's a structuring of individuals into certain categories as a part of a hierarchy, but rather the caste system can be seen as a symbol of or an allegory for one's duty in life, whatever that duty may be, not something necessarily imposed on one by a government or outside influences, but whatever one's innate duty is. So the caste system is a very controversial aspect of Indian culture. Many philosophers in the modern age are discussing its relevance or its irrelevance to the Hindu tradition, where it fits and what should be done about it on a practical societal level. But I think that can be somewhat divorced from the essential message and meaning of the Gita. Well, we're just simply recognizing that it's rooted in this society where the caste system existed, and so of course it's going to discuss certain aspects of the caste system as part of its teachings.
Okay, I'm going. Will be one last question.
Yes, I think it's intimately connected with how the world proceeds. There is obviously a method for it to proceed.
Yes.
And as you say, sometimes you have to fight, or you have to act. And by doing that, you and the other learn something that you wouldn't have learned in any other way.
And that's why the Gita being rooted in this evolutionary framework, perhaps it's by these conflicts that evolution then occurs. And also, yes, it does offer a way forward. It does offer some hope for the future. It does offer a method whereby one may discover what is right action and how to live and how to resolve conflicts.
I think that's partly happening now.
Yes, even Gandhi considered the Gita to be his primary inspiration in his own social philosophy and his own political actions.
The present situation, don't want to get into that, but the way this man is proceeding, it's making people do things, and from doing those things they learn a whole lot.
Yes. And of course, sometimes lessons are very rarely something we want to learn. They're usually something that are imposed upon us, and from which we then have to learn how to deal with the conflicts that arise in our life and develop from such. So yes, I don't think we choose to learn many of the lessons that we learn. I think they are the result of they're what we need to learn, but learning is often a painful process.
Yes.
The Don't learn it on the first time,
second or third, eventually we'll learn it. Okay, I'm going to draw the line there. I'm sure Luke is happy to chat to people.
Yes.
Over a cup of tea. And I think these are pamphlets.
These are all free, so please have yourself two copies. I've got transcripts of today's talk available here. I'm sorry for any typos, because it's a bit of a last minute.
How old are you?
I'm 22 years old.
You will go a long way, because you've done really well.
Thank you very much.
And got a right good grasp of things, you know,
thank
for your age.
Thank you very much.
Thank you all for coming.
Yeah.
Yes.
Thank you.
This one here is the beginning sections of a full-length book I'm currently in the process of writing. These are my articles on Hindu philosophy and scriptural studies, done as a result of my studies with the University of Oxford.